Yes, I am here. Good morning.
Good morning to you. Now, can you please give us an update on the story? You know, the last time we checked and saw the package, it showed, of course, students packing up, going back home and leaving the university. But what is the latest?
Well, the latest, at least from Nairobi, is that the university, of course, has been closed. Here in Nairobi, relatives of those who lost their lives have begun, you know, the painful process of identifying their remains. We were earlier at the mortuary, and we saw very, very old parents coming to look for their children, brothers coming to look for their children. And so that is a process that is expected to go through all the day. Hundreds of Kenyans are here at the mortuary trying to identify the remains of their loved ones. The mortuary is saying it is overwhelmed by the numbers that have been received. And it appears that actually the death toll may be higher than the 147 that we knew. Is official from the government.
And, you know, one of the, you know, ambulance officials and medical officials from St. John's Ambulance had actually explained that, you know, it was horrific, of course, to get into the room and find, you know, some students who were actually killed in a separate, you know, hall altogether. Have you spoken to them about, you know, the horrific images that they witnessed there?
As a mortuary, we've not been able to get any survivor, but you hear stories of the last moments, children trying to call the people who are outside to come and help, other people calling their parents on their phones, ladies who call their boyfriends the last minute asking for help, even saying where they are just before the shootout happened. We do not know if indeed there were people who, you know, may have been killed in another place. What we know is that the parents talk about desperate moments, desperate calls for help, and that some of them saying the siege lasted too long, others feeling that if something had been done faster, maybe more lives would have been saved and more people would have been rescued than the numbers we are talking about now.
Now, Sarah, we understand that police have detained two people in connection with the attack. Do you have any information regarding that?
Yes, we understand that two people have been detained, and the police say they are helping them with investigations, but they have not linked them to the attack completely, saying whether they were inside the hall. But they're saying that they may have had information on these people, where they slept the night before they carried out the attack. But the problem is, in a place like Garissa, where a lot of people had gone through such brutality from the Kenya police when previous attacks had happened, it may be difficult even to be able to get real information or the truth from people who may have known the attackers or who may actually be related to the attackers.
And Sarah, there has been a letter circulating on social media, specifically also on Facebook, as a letter coming from the security officers from the university warning the country, warning government of possible attacks. Some people previously thought that it was a hoax or said perhaps it was an April Fool's. But how legit, how valid was this letter, and did it reach government?
Indeed, we knew that universities were on high alert. We presently saw a letter from the University of Nairobi and another one from one of the main private universities here warning students that they must remain alert. The British High Commission, the British government, days earlier had heightened their alert and issued a travel advisory, a fresh travel advisory. Yesterday, the government admitting indeed they were caught by surprise. However, a lot of media houses here reporting that indeed the government had intelligence information earlier but refused to act on it.
And of course, President Uhuru Kenyatta, Sarah, said on Thursday that urgent steps must, of course, be made complete, of course, regarding the recruitment of 10,000 new police officers. Have they recruited the police officers yet?
Well, the police officers have actually now started reporting to the training college. It is a group of young people who had been recruited earlier, but a case was filed in court, and so that process was halted. So all they're doing now is reporting to the college so that they can begin training. But it will take about 6 months before they can, you know, graduate and join the forces. Also, people feeling that it is not so much the lack of enough security officers, but, you know, the are they well equipped? Is their morale high? Are they able to, you know, work with integrity and not take bribes at the borders? Because the Kenya-Somali border is quite long, 700 kilometers. And there is a feeling that in most cases, the Kenya police have either been lax or they have accepted bribes and let people who are questionable character, of people who come later to attack Kenyans get through. But also, in places like Garissa, these people who could be attackers have lived there for a long time. We have Kenyan al-Qaeda cells in the country, so these could be people from the sleeper cells. It is difficult to tell indeed if these were Kenyans who carried out the attack, or it is because of lack of security inside the country that indeed it happened.
And let's take a look at the national, broader perspective here, Sarah. You know, the last time I asked you this question was during the malls attacks still in Kenya by suspected Al-Shabaab militants when they, of course, walked into the mall and opened fire. But, you know, regarding, of course, you know, the recent attacks on the university, I mean, there's been a series of foreign travel warnings in response to these attacks. How have these attacks affected tourism's industry?
They have affected the tourism industry because there have been mass layoffs in the tourism in the other coasts of Kenya where most of the hotels are and where the beaches are. We find that a lot of hotels are actually closing down. It is now the high season because of the Easter season, but they're already complaining that the numbers are low. When we look at the results from the Kenya Tourism Board, they say that the numbers continue to go down, and especially because every time an attack like this happens, the Western governments heighten their alert and the issue travel advisories. And so what has happened is that in the effect, since the attack started, the hotels have found themselves empty. Not even Kenyans now want to go, you know, very far off, pick a door to see away. But what it has also done is that it has made Kenyans more aware. You find that in the malls, in churches, in mosques, there's a lot of security. You find you cannot enter anywhere without going through a thorough body search. But the problem is, it only happens immediately after an attack like this. And after that, you know, people relax and go back to normal. And that's when, again, they are caught unawares.
Sarah Kimani, always a pleasure talking to you. Thank you so much for that update. That was our SABC reporter, Sarah Kimani, coming to us, of course, live from Kenya, updating us on the Garissa University attacks.